Thank you to the organizers, to Marius, for bringing together such a diverse group of people. Also, thank them for organizing such wonderful weather during the week of the meeting here in Lumigny. And finally, thanks to the audience who got up and came at 9 o'clock in the morning. So the conference is about ergodic theory and connections with arithmetic and combinatorics, and I'm going to give you a talk just about the beginning, just about ergodic theory. And I'm going to go back to one of the first introductions to ergodic theory that appeared in English. These are the lectures of Halmos that appeared exactly 60 years ago. At the end of this brief book, which is still quite a good introduction to basic ergodic theory, Halmos gave a list of 10 unsolved problems. 10 years ago, 50 years after the book appeared, I gave a talk also about the unsolved problems. There won't be very much overlap between these talks, and I think it's also safe for me to say that I don't think anybody in the audience was at any of these earlier talks of mine. And I'm not going to go through all of the problems. I'll begin by saying a few words about the problem with which I've been most concerned with during my career. This is the third problem, and it reads as follows. The outstanding algebraic problem of ergodic theory is the problem of conjugacy. When are two transformations conjugate? And Halmos is using the algebraic terminology of conjugacy, whereas today we speak usually of isomorphism. So he's thinking of two measure-preserving transformations, x b mu t, finite measure space, y c nu s. And these are conjugate, or as we say today, isomorphic, if there's a measure-preserving invertible mapping between these systems that intertwines the action of T and S. He then goes on to ask, this is vague, of course, but there are some interesting and quite specific yes or no questions connected with it that should be solved. And then he goes on to list three yes or no questions, and all of them were solved within about less than 15 years after he posed them, using the notion of entropy, which he missed by just a few years in this introductory book. So the first one concerns Bernoulli shifts, which, as you all know, was solved by Kolmogorov, and, or I hope, you all know Kolmogorov and Ornstein. The second is, do there exist two equivalent but non-conjugate transformations with continuous spectrum? So by equivalent, he means unitarily equivalent. So together with the measure-preserving equivalence, so this is measurable isomorphism, he's talking about unitary equivalence where you look at the L2 space and the induced unitary operator. So UT, this is the Koopman operator, which T induces on L2, and unitary equivalent means that UT is unitarily equivalent to US. And here, spectrally, one knows exactly what the spectrum and the multiplicity classify unitary operators. And he's asking, are there two ergodic transformations with continuous spectrum? Because there were at that time already examples using skew products, but they had pure point spectrum as well. He's asking for unitarily equivalent transformations with continuous spectrum, which are not measurably isomorphic. And this, of course, has a simple answer. For example, you can use entropy to distinguish between the horocycle flow and the Bernoulli shift, both of which have Lebesgue spectrum with countable multiplicity. By the way, if I realize the audience is mixed and I will not be writing so many things on the board, even though there was in the recent notices an article about how teachers of mathematics often make the mistake of keeping the main things, points that they want to get across, not written on the blackboard, whereas students focus on what's written on the blackboard and copy diligently what's on the blackboard, but don't pay so much attention to what the lecturer is saying. You might look at the article and the notices in Docamus Mathematica concerned with teaching of mathematics. It's interesting, and I think we all make such mistakes when giving talks in conferences. So if you want to clarify something, please raise your hand. Or not raise your hand, just speak up. So. Okay. And the third one is, do there exist two conjugate ergodic automorphisms of a compact group that do not belong to the same conjugacy class in the group of all automorphisms of the group? So here you could be speaking about automorphisms of the torus. There's an algebraic conjugacy, and the question is, can there be automorphisms of the torus which are measurably isomorphic but not algebraically conjugate? And with Roy Adler, who sadly passed away a few months ago, we answered this question in our work on the when we showed that entropy classifies the automorphism of the torus, and we gave some examples of automorphisms which were not algebraically conjugate but had the same entropy. So this is sort of all quite old material, and I'm not going to dwell on it very much. I said I should point out that in the abstract, I also said that these questions, all of which he's, all of the questions that he's asking concern actions of Z, and you can replace Z by any countable or locally compact group, but let's stick to countable group. And probably the most dramatic progress on this has been made in the last 10 years in non-amenable countable groups, where the problem of classifying Bernoulli shifts over these groups has been dramatically solved, mainly by the work of Lewis Bowen. So I should mention his work. And before I, so this is for Suffolk groups. Again, I'm not going to dwell on that very much, but I should say something about his first comment. This is vague, of course. So the problem of conjugacy is vague, and there has been work in the last, say, 15 years on making this vague problem more precise using notions from descriptive set theory. And again, I'm not going to talk about that because of the lack of time. Now I come to problem 5. And I'll probably begin by spending a little time on problem 5. What unitary operators are induced by measure-preserving transformations? So measure-preserving transformation induces a unitary operator, and the question is, what unitary operators come from? So this is problem 5. I'll probably maybe write it down. What unitary operators come from measure-preserving systems? Okay, what's the simplest unitary operator? The shift on little l2 of z. That's the simplest unitary operator. And, excuse me a second, the shift on little L2 of Z, the spectrum here is called Lebesgue spectrum, multiplicity 1, so is the shift on L2 UT for some ergodic measure preserving transformation. And this is sometimes called Banach's problem, and when Banach formulated it, he formulates it for a measure space, not making it clear whether he means a finite or an infinite measure space. Halmos, when he formulates this question, it's sort of, he writes it down, and then he says, does there exist a measure-preserving transformation on a space of finite? And he puts that finite so it's clearly formulated to find a finite measure-preserving transformation, and this problem is still wide open. Probably the main open problem in spectral theory or relations with spectral theory, and I have nothing really to say about it. I certainly won't try to give you the history of failed attempts on this problem or partial results. This is a, I think, a fascinating story, but not for this talk today. And anyway, I don't know it all that well.
If you wish to look finite, is it known?
Okay, I'm not sure. I'm not sure about that. Okay, so unitary operators are given by a spectral measure. So fix a measure, on the unit circle, say d rho, then there always is a measure-preserving transformation that has rho as part of its spectrum. So this is the Gaussian process. This is a stationary ergodic. And the joint distribution of the Xn is Gaussian, multivariable Gaussian. And the covariance, which we heard about, the expected value C of n. This is a positive definite sequence, and it's the Fourier transform of a measure. And you can take any positive measure, take its Fourier transform, you get a positive definite sequence, and you can use this covariance function to define a Gaussian process, because in order to define the Gaussian distribution, you just have to define the pairwise, the covariance function, the multidimensional covariance function. Stationarity means that if you have it for zero, and n, you have it for any pair. So there's always is a Gaussian process, which you can think of as a measure-preserving transformation, and d rho becomes part of the spectrum. It's the spectrum of the first Gauss. Halmos's question is really to characterize the full spectral measure of the transformation, and here what you get is, if you do this Gaussian construction, you get, in addition to d rho, you get the various tensor products of d rho and the higher chaos, and any such measure, of course, can be realized but it's far from a characterization of what spectral measures with multiplicities can arise as measure-preserving transformations. Now I wanted to say a few words about a remarkable relationship between, which also relates to his question about unitary equivalence implying measure-preserving equivalence. So, in pure point spectrum, as you're probably all aware of, in pure point spectrum, for ergodic systems, Halmos and von Neumann made first von Neumann in principle, but it's usually called Halmos von Neumann. They wrote a beautiful paper on this. Halmos von Neumann showed that unitary equivalence implies measurable isomorphism. And of course, if and only if, and these are the rotations on compact groups. So this is well known. I emphasize ergodic because for non-ergodic systems, the spectrum no longer characterizes the measurable isomorphism. There are counterexamples, perhaps not so well known. Now, there's a remarkable theorem, more than 40 years old, of Foyas and Stratila, and just so that I have some idea of who I'm speaking to. So those who know the Foyas-Stratila theorem that I'm about to say, please raise your hand. Don't be ashamed, it's not okay. And those who don't, please raise your hand. Okay, so I'm going to teach you something new, even though it's quite an old result. It's a kind of remarkable fact. Yeah, so for this I need a notion from harmonic analysis, and I will repeat this exercise. I need the notion of a Kronecker set in harmonic analysis. Now let's try this again. Those who know what a Kronecker set is, please raise your hand. Okay, those who don't know what a Kronecker set is, please raise your hand. Okay, so I still have something to teach you in harmonic analysis. Although Bernard, who's sitting in the audience, could do a much better job than me on this because he's far more of an expert in this harmonic analysis than I am. But in any event, Kronecker set is a closed subset of the circle K such that for every continuous function on K, complex valued continuous function, and every epsilon, there exists an N such that e to the 2 pi I n t minus f of t sup on K is less than epsilon. So you can approximate uniformly continuous functions on the set by characters. And it's called a Kronecker set because if on the circle you have a finite number of points which are rationally independent, so a finite set, finite set, rationally independent is a Kronecker set. And this is Kronecker's theorem. This is a theorem on simultaneous approximation. Okay. So there are countersets that have this property, and it's kind of a pretty easy exercise to construct these by simply starting with a finite set, which is rationally independent, and starting with one continuous function. and then saying, well, we can approximate. You list the continuous functions in some order, polynomials, rational coefficients, and then you start this approximation, and you thicken the sets just a little bit, and in a neighborhood you can still do things, and then you take more independent points in that neighborhood, and you go on and you make a Cantor set. Okay.
So you are taking a function from K into T.
Every CK, I should have said, whew, somewhere there's something to capture boards with. Yes, we can capture a board. Yes. For every C of K, every continuous function with modulus 1. Yes, I should have said that. Okay. I'm glad that somebody is paying attention. Now, okay, so. Yeah. Foyer Stratila theorem. Xn is a real valued ergodic process, and its spectral measure is continuous, so no point spectrum, continuous with support in a Kronecker set then Xn has a Gaussian distribution as a process. So the Gaussian construction is the unique ergodic process that can have a spectral measure, continuous spectral measure with support in the Kronecker set. As I said in my introduction, I think this result is sort of belongs in the discussion on this fifth problem of Halmos, of the relationship between the spectral properties and the ergodic properties of a system. These Kronecker Gaussian systems have been extensively studied, but as far as I know, when you replace the group of the integers by a multidimensional ZD, and so I list here a question, is the analog of Forest Tractor valid for commuting transformations? I'll write it this way. I think this is an interesting question. You can ask this, of course, not only for you can ask this for any abelian group. The notion of Kronecker set makes sense, although you have to modify it when you have torsion in the group. So this is the kind of natural setting for the generalization. I was planning to give a very brief outline of a partial answer to this question. I'll do this very briefly. So I know, I think, a partial answer. So what is the question here? We have a two-parameter, let's say, for Z2. We have now an ergodic process. And we have the two-dimensional spectral measure. It's now on the torus. And it's supported on a Kronecker set on the torus. And the question is, must this be Gaussian? So the partial answer that I can give is, I think, the following result theorem. Suppose K, a Kronecker set in T2 with projection onto the first coordinate of K, also a Kronecker set in T1, and suppose that X and M is not only ergodic as a Z2 action, but also in the X direction, in the T direction. So I think of the action here, but also, I'll just write it, X0N as a one-dimensional process is ergodic. What? I mean this. XN0, I guess. Well, you'll see. I may confuse X and Y, but you'll see in the sketch of the proof what I really have in mind is ergodic in one of the directions, sort of the same direction that I get a Kronecker set when I project, then X and M is ergodic. Is Gaussian, I'm sorry, ergodic is Gaussian. Yeah, this is this is what I wanted to say, and let me give you a brief sketch of a proof. And this will also give a brief sketch of the proof of the Feuer-Stratila theorem, because we need to start with that. So, let's go over here. Let's go here. So for the Feuer-Stratila theorem, what do we have? We have a process Xn, and we have its spectral measure, rho, and we have between the span, the L2 span of Xn and the L2 of the torus with d rho, we have an isometry. This is what the spectral theorem is saying. Now, what you do is you define a stochastic process here, y0t, by looking here at the indicator function of the interval 0t as an element in this L2 space. So this indicator function, of course, is an L2 function, and it corresponds to a process where t is the parameter. It's now a continuous time process. And then the way the proof goes, there are two steps. Step one, use the Kronecker property. And this I want to show that the y0t process has independent increments. This is the probabilistic language for saying that when you look at the differences, I mean, you define y for an interval AB to be y0t b minus y 0 a. This is the difference of the indicator functions. This is the increment. And now independent increments means that if you take disjoint intervals, a1, b1, a2, b2, these random variables are independent. So you use the Kronecker property to show that you have independent increments. And then rho is continuous. And you use that to prove, and this requires a proof, prove that the paths y0 t omega as for fixed omega as a function of t are the paths are almost surely continuous. Then use a theorem that says that such continuous path processes with independent increments are Gaussian. So what you deduce is that the y0t is Gaussian, but then the whole Hilbert space that it spans is Gaussian, and this is the same as the Hilbert space, this is L2. So this is the way the Feuerstratteler theorem is proved. And when you try to do this on the torus, you have your Kronecker set on the torus, and again you can define a process. The indicator function, you define now a two-dimensional random process. Find a two-dimensional random process using the same L2 isomorphism. And step one goes through easily to show that you have independent increments. Where independent increments means now that when you look at the process that corresponds to disjoint little squares or little rectangles or little sets or whatever, these are independent. This goes through in the same way. But now you need an analog of this second part. And the theory of stochastic processes with two indices, I mean, these are random fields, that theory becomes quite a bit more involved and more complicated. And it may be that one could carry out the analog of two, but under the hypotheses that I've given here, there's a quick way to complete the proof at this point. And the quick way is the following. You look at this slice of your process. And this slice of your process has for its spectral measure the projection of your measure onto this coordinate. You're just looking at somehow functions that depend on one variable. And the assumption of ergodicity and the fact that this projection is a Kronecker set, so ergodicity plus projection is a Kronecker set, this implies that you can use the one-dimensional or the classical Feuerstratteler theorem to get something which is Gaussian. And what is Gaussian? It's what corresponds to these slices. Now, how do you go from that to the Gaussian distribution of the others? And there is, okay, now I should raise. Yep, no. Raise, and then raise this one. Yeah. Okay, now we still have something left. And now comes the Deus Ex Machina, Cramer's theorem. So I'm going back to classic probability. So again, I'd like to make this vote. Who knows Cramer's theorem? Which theorem of Cramer? Who knows a Cramer's theorem which might be relevant in this situation? Okay, so what is Cramer's theorem? If X and Y are independent random variables, and X plus Y has a Gaussian distribution, so what do we know? We have two random variables, and we know that their sum has a Gaussian distribution. What can you say about X and Y? Then, both X and Y are Gaussian. Okay, so this might seem like a surprising result. It is a surprising result. I mean, certainly surprised me when I first encountered this. The proof is not so difficult, although I don't know of a proof that does not go via characteristic functions. In other words, a non-analytic proof of this, I don't know, although the statement is, I mean, it's like looking for elementary proofs of the prime number theorem. You know, it's sometimes it teaches you something. In any event, I have never seen anybody try to prove this without using characteristic functions. But when you apply Cramer's theorem to this situation, we're done, because if we come back, we know that thin strips are Gaussian, and then we know that when you cut them into pieces, they're independent. So everything becomes Gaussian, and the problem is finished. I repeat, I don't know the sort of general, I have the question still up there, for a general Kronecker set without this additional assumption of ergodicity, which is needed for the Fourier-Stratula theorem, I don't really know how to proceed. So this was a little bit of an excursion, a mild excursion into some maybe probability theory. Maybe this would have fit better last week. There was probability theory in the title of one of the workshops, but in any event, okay. So there are more problems, and I'm going to spend the last sort of 15 minutes discussing the ninth problem. Okay, so problem nine. So I start reading it to you and I'll put something on the board. A curious conjugacy invariant is suggested by automorphisms on compact abelian groups. So as you can imagine, there weren't so many examples which were well studied by that time, and automorphisms of compact abelian groups were certainly one of them. Suppose X is a torus, T is the automorphism corresponding to a unimodular matrix, M, A, B, C, D. K is the trace. And simplify matters, assume that the determinant is plus one. So AD minus BC equals plus one. The fact that M satisfies the Hamilton-Cayley equation, M squared minus KM plus identity equals zero, yes, yes, implies that if F is a character, then U squared F, UF to the minus K times F is equal to 1. He's just exponentiated, applied a character, and used this U he's writing for the unitary operator, which is induced by. So U is what I was calling U is UM. It's the Koopman operator associated to the automorphism. The existence or non-existence of Fs satisfying such identities is a conjugacy invariant of T. So he's asking, when does a measure-preserving transformation have a non-constant function which satisfies this equation? Notice that unlike point spectrum where you only are applying U, here you're applying U squared and you're writing some polynomial in this. Sample question, if N is another unimodular matrix and the characteristic equation is different, does there exist a non-constant function such that V squared F... okay, so now he has another matrix and he has another V, which is V N prime, where this is a different matrix, a different system. Can you solve this equation with this transformation? So can you get V squared F, VF minus KF equals 1? So to put this question into a kind of more general framework, you could take any polynomial, take any polynomial over Z, let's say irreducible, constant term 1, so maybe some P, and then you write P, maybe I'll put in a T here, TF equals 1. What this means is that if the polynomial P of Z is Z to the N plus A1 Z to the N minus 1 plus AN minus 1 Z plus 1, then what this means is that you're looking at T to the N F times T to the N minus 1 F to the A1 times F is equal to 1. Now you're looking at this equation and you're asking, when does a system, when does a measure-preserving transformation have a function of unit modulus which satisfies such an equation? So this is clearly an isomorphism invariant. He was looking for invariants. And as far as this question goes, so there's a, this question is essentially solved in a recent paper by Quas and Sue. Anthony Quas, Terry Sue, I guess. The paper appeared, I guess, this year. Although preprint was already around a couple of years ago. And what do they prove that is relevant to this question? So what they show is the following. If T D A is an ergodic, let me call it T. You'll forgive me for the torus, is an ergodic automorphism of the torus and XB mu S is any ergodic system with entropy with the entropy less than the entropy of T. So this ergodic automorphism had positive entropy, some log of the so the entropy of T is the sum of the log over the eigenvalues which are bigger than one. These are the eigenvalues. So you start with an arbitrary ergodic system that has smaller entropy, then there is an invariant measure. Mu tilde of T on the torus such that mu tilde T is isomorphic to your system. So you can get represent any system. They call this universality. They have a kind of general theorem for when is a topological system universal in this sense. When can it represent all ergodic systems that satisfy the entropy constraint? Now, it's pretty easy to see how this result gives a kind of very definite negative answer to Halmos's hope of finding a new conjugacy invariant, because what this is showing is basically that any ergodic system, you always have zero entropy factors, and that's all that matters. You can always represent it on a torus with this prescribed automorphism that has as its characteristic polynomial the polynomial T, and then the polynomial P. So if the characteristic polynomial of T is the given P, is P of Z, then a character will solve this in X, because you can lift the character via this isomorphism back to the original system. You can represent this character as a function on the system that you're describing. There is some issue about polynomials. I have to eliminate here irreducible non-cyclotomic. For cyclotomic polynomials, you have to worry about periodicity. You have to worry about the rational spectrum. So the discussion I've just given will take care of all transformations. If you also want cyclotomic polynomials, then you have to worry about the rational spectrum. And then you come into a problem that they don't know, namely, if you take a periodic system, for what cyclotomic polynomials can you find functions on that finite system? So here's a question. You have some periodic system, Z mod MZ. What cyclotomic polynomials represented in the sense that I've described here in Z mod MZ, just adding one, just this periodic system. So they give an example of the system on 2 points. They have an example with system on 2 points where the cyclotomic polynomial, now I forget the notation, somebody will help me. For every integer, there's a cyclotomic polynomial corresponding to that integer, the primitive roots. What is the standard notation for cyclotomic polynomials?
Capital?
Capital phi. Okay. So you can define a function here which will satisfy the equation that corresponds to phi 6, which is a little unexpected. I mean, you can certainly satisfy here phi m and anything which divides m, but that you can find a function here which satisfies this is a little surprising. And they don't know somehow the general...
Then that's quadratic polynomial, right?
Yeah, it's a quadratic polynomial. Yes. It'd be hard to do something non-quadratic. You have only two... This is two-point space. I mean, it's and the values are a third, two-thirds. I mean, the function is this. And, you can check that. It's a simple example that they give in their paper that's very nice. Okay, so I thought I would give you some idea of, they have a much more general theorem. They have a theorem that shows that if a space satisfies three conditions, I started a little late. I'll write it down quickly. So they're dealing with a general system. Let me call it omega t. So this is a topological system. And using three, under the assumption that this satisfies three properties, which I write down here like this, almost weak specification. It sounds a little wishy-washy, but it's a kind of strong condition about periodic orbits. There are lots of periodic points, and you can paste together periodic orbits. There's something here called the small boundary property. Which is satisfied for finite dimensional spaces. And there's something here called entropy expansive, which I'm not going to attempt to define. Under these properties, they show that you have this universality for omega tau. And when I first saw their result, I had trouble reading their proof, so I tried to work out a proof on my own, and I came up with a proof which doesn't use this condition. So you can get the same result just with 1 and 2, I don't want to write anything down formally because...
1 and 2 apply positive entropy.
Excuse me?
1 and 2 apply positive entropy?
The universality is for systems that have... I mean, this already pretty much implies positive entropy, but 1 and 2, you get some positive entropy, but anyway, you assume that the system you're trying to represent has entropy less than, strictly less than the topological entropy. You can't reach the maximum. The maximal entropy might be unique. There's no hope of getting lots of transformations with lots of measures with that. So there's always a strict inequality between the topological entropy of the universal system and what you're representing. Just as there is in Krieger's theorem, which is the first universality theorem of this type. You just take the shift on A symbols and its universals for all ergodic systems with entropy strictly less than log A. That's the original universal system. Okay, I don't want to... We'll leave time for questions, yes.
Question?
Yes.
questions for our speaker?
So the problems that are left open, the main, which, what would be your favorite?
Okay, the last problem which I didn't mention is the problem, does two mixing, or does mixing imply mixing of higher order? I didn't mention that. In spite of the beautiful partial results that have been obtained, the general question is still wide open. Bernard probably better than me could give a talk about this problem as well with discussing the partial results. Here's an example where as soon as you go beyond Z, already Le Drapier many years ago showed that you don't expect a positive answer. So the question is strict open, but strictly for Z. This kind of universality question, these polynomials, you could easily generalize to, you can generalize to some extent under appropriate conditions, you can generalize this theorem of universality, theorem of Poisson-Sue, you can generalize to ZD actions. I think not so much with their proof, but the proof that I had would give it to you with some appropriate, almost weak specification, which is much more complicated to state, and there are many variants of this in Z2.
Any other questions? Thank our speaker.